So, Lori, what is a good age to potty train a child?
That's a good question, Marae. Let's ask our very own favorite pediatrician.
Hi, girls. What are you doing?
What are you guys doing? Thanks for warming up the chairs for us. If you guys head out there, we gotta start getting ready to tape our show. We'll see you in a little bit, okay? Wonder what they were talking about.
I wonder. So, Laurie, at what age do you think a child should be potty trained?
Well, that's a good question, Murray. I'm not sure there's one right age. Thank goodness we have our favorite pediatrician here to ask today. But before we do, what age did you do with Ari?
One and a half.
She was 1.5?
Mm-hmm.
My kids were more like 3 or 4. I think they were maybe 5 before we even finished the potty training process. So even between the two of us, we have such a diversity of experience.
Yeah, and we survived.
We did. The kids survived and we survived.
Speaking of surviving and thriving, hi, my name is Mireille Lee, and this is Parenting in Action, and this is my co-host.
I'm Lori Sherman. I am both a mother of 3, that was my youngest child that was warming up the seat, and your child as well. And I am also the Child and Family Policy Advisor for Mayor Menino. And we've created the show to be able to help us with everything from potty training to tantrums. I'm talking about the kids' tantrums, not always our tantrums. Yes. Parenting through a crisis, learning about autism, asthma. So we cover a different topic every week, and today we're talking about potty training. And we do have a wonderful pediatrician here with us. Before I mention that, if you go to parentinginaction.org, you can watch the old episodes on any of the topics that I've just mentioned, as well as many other topics like learning how to help our kids sleep through the night. So our pediatrician who comes to see us every 2 or 3 months is Eileen Costello. Welcome.
Thank you, Lori.
You have helped us so much with so many topics. I've talked to so many people about the sleeping through the night ideas that you gave us.
One of my favorite topics.
Yeah, we're not torturing kids. We're actually giving them a gift, sleep. But it feels like torture.
I know.
So I know you have 3 sons
I
of
do.
Your own, and you've been through this. What I can't remember is how long have you been a pediatrician?
I have been in practice for 22 years.
And you live in Jamaica Point?
I live in JP. I work in JP. And before that, I worked at in Dorchester. So I've worked in neighborhood health centers in Boston my entire career.
That's great. And we are also both Bostonians.
Yes.
So we're all living it day in, day out. So what we wanted to do was have you just start by walking us through potty training. The joke I've heard from people is nobody enters college in diapers. So it will happen at some point and we don't need to make ourselves quite as stressed as we often do. So we're hoping you can just walk us through the basic information of is there a correct age and how do we think about this in a way that, that decreases our stress?
It's such an interesting topic because there is no right age for any particular child. It really depends on the child and the family and what's going on in the child and the family's lives at a certain time. So the range is anywhere from about 18 months is on the early side. You know, about age 3 is on the later side, but I've had many kids who have trained well after age 3 in my practice and who have gone on to, you know, live long and healthy lives.
Yeah.
So really depends, and you'll, just from listening to the two of you, there are enormous cultural differences too. Mm-hmm. Certain cultures expect kids to be trained earlier and other cultures don't think, seem to think that that's such a high priority.
Mm-hmm.
But the most important thing is making sure that that the child is ready and understands what the process is before you even get started.
And are there, I know we have some basic information that you brought for us with sort of key points, differences generally between boys and girls?
Girls tend to be a little bit earlier in this skill than boys, but not necessarily easier in the process, just that their motor skills in terms of toileting seem to go a little bit quicker than they do for boys.
Well, I don't know about that, Eileen, because I remember the reason why Ariel starts so early is because when I would be sitting on the toilet potty, she would be trying to pull me off and then she'll try to sit.
Wow. So well, that's just a great, so if the child expresses interest, that's a good time to at least bring a potty into your house, introduce your child to the potty, have your child make friends with the potty chair, and practice. And sometimes those early the kids that are interested very early, it doesn't always last. I mean, sometimes it does, and sometimes it's just a momentary thing, and we get a little excited. Oh, she's 13 months. She's going to train. And she might be interested for a week and then not interested for another 6 months. So you just have to kind of go with the flow and follow their signals about whether they're really taking this on and ready to move forward.
So talk about this idea of making friends with the potty. Like, I don't remember any of this because, again, we did it late and slowly and just whenever it was, you know, it was one of those things that was nice that it wasn't a big deal.
Right.
And I feel for the parents that find it a really big deal. So if using this potty, which I have not seen in so many years, yes. What do you mean by making friends with it? And
well, for a lot of kids, there's a little bit of anxiety or fear just about, you know, taken off their diaper and putting their stool or their poop or whatever language you use in your family, you know, someplace other than a diaper. And so watching you is an excellent, you know, kids need to see what we do. Mm-hmm. Kids need to witness the flushing because mm-hmm. I think that sometimes there's a mystery around it. Yeah. What's going on here? And then the reason why we like potty chairs is because the child can be comfortable in a potty chair, you know, sitting with their feet firmly planted, you know, it feels much safer for the child. Mm-hmm. Some people will take like a potty like this, the top will come off and you can put right on the toilet. And if you decide to do that, which of course makes the cleaning up much easier, then you just want to make sure there's a stool or something so the child can put his feet and feel sort of safe and secure and not have his feet dangling, because it's very hard to go through the process if your feet are kind of dangling off the edge there.
And what were you, I'm sorry, were you asking?
No, I was gonna make a comment regarding Dr. Oz, since mm-hmm. I love Dr. Oz. He mentioned about, you know, when you are going to the bathroom, it is good to sit straight and be firm. So yeah, I could see the correlation you're saying to have something under your feet,
right.
Because you do feel more relaxed.
Right. Right, exactly.
Oh, interesting, yeah. Okay.
And what were you telling me about introduce it and have a child sit on the potty a little bit before, after breakfast, a little bit after dinner with their clothes on
so
at first?
If there's any anxiety at all about taking down their pants or taking off their diaper or anything, just let them sit. I'll tell parents, once kids start expressing a little interest, let them sit 5 minutes twice a day, like maybe after breakfast, 45 minutes or an hour after breakfast, and the same after dinner, because that's when you'll be most likely to have some event happen mm-hmm. after eating. Mm-hmm. And so even if the first couple of weeks is just taking a book, sitting there, putting the timer on for 5 minutes, no stress, and then a lot of kids respond to reward systems like a sticker chart, mm-hmm. put a little star on a sticker chart just for sitting there. Mm-hmm. And actually, kids kind of like that, because if you're reading to them, you know, and then just they get comfortable with the whole idea of, oh, this isn't so bad, this is no big deal. And then gradually, I mean, it's a process. And so usually it takes 2 to 3 months for most kids to really get through the process from beginning to end, to really know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. If we start too early, it's going to take longer. Mm-hmm. If you start late when they're really, really ready, sometimes it's done in a couple of weeks.
That's an interesting point that you helped me to understand, that starting earlier, if a child shows interest, like clearly Ari showed clear interest, but if a child's not and you start early, it's just going to take you as long as it would to the same age as when you waited for the child to show interest.
And it may turn into a struggle, which is the one thing you don't want. You want to try to make this as positive an experience as possible for the child. Because it's not a fight or a battle that you're going to win very easily.
Yeah, because that's what I was thinking as you and Lori are commenting about the, you know, the early starting. Because when you look at it, this is Mother Nature in action. So it's a natural process. So you should let the child naturally go into that process. Because who wants to be forced to do anything?
Right.
Think about it.
Sometimes kids will give you a little signal that they know what's happening. You know, when you just think about a newborn, they have no concept. Mm-hmm. Things are coming out, you know, from the front, from the back, and the baby has no control and no appreciation. Mm-hmm. As they get older, you know, sometimes when a child wakes up from a nap and they're dry and they've been asleep for 2 or 3 hours, that's a signal that they have some control over their bladder. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, parents will describe, well, when he needs to go, he goes into the corner and screws up his face, and mm-hmm. you know, then I know he's recognizing these signals. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that can be an opportunity to try to talk to the child. You know, if they have some language, which you would want them to have some language to understand this process, you can say, oh, that means you need to poop. Let's go. Mm-hmm. And sometimes let's go, and even if you're going to do it standing up in your diaper, there's a room for it.
Yes, yes.
Well, you could do it in there, and then take the process along like that.
You know, now you are making me recollect my memories, because I do remember when Ari was doing those things, I would always, you know, communicate with her, say, Mama, do you want to go pee-pee? You know, do you feel like you got to go pee-pee? And she'd be like, pee-pee, pee-pee. And I'm like, yeah, toilet.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, if they start doing the dance,
yeah,
that is a way you can teach them. That's what that means.
Exactly.
Your body is telling you something.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
now this means you're maybe ready to start this process.
Yeah.
So why do you think it is, we're making it sound simple, but I know from talking to other parents, and I know from you telling me that it's a very common thing that it's not simple, that there's a lot of struggle. Why do we, how do we avoid turning into a struggle, and how do we?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that it's such a great question, because there's such a range. A lot of it really depends on the temperament of the child, which I think we don't give enough importance to children's personalities and temperament as we should. We accept that as adults we're all different, we have different likes and dislikes, but we kind of have this expectation that, you know, if the neighbor's child was trained at 18 months, my child too should be trained
mm-hmm.
at 18 months.
Okay.
And it just isn't like that. So some children might be ready to do it, and then many of them won't be able to do it for another year or two after that.
Mm-hmm.
And some of it is just temperament, whether they have some anxiety about it, whether they're trying to achieve other milestones of toddlerhood, you know, whether they're really working on their language, or they're really working on their play skills, or they're really working on sleeping through the night.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you just can't overload a small child with too many tasks at the same time.
Mm-hmm. So you're talking a little bit about peer pressure, and I remember you talked about that as well. You know, so mm-hmm. if there's a grandparent in the house that's saying, well, when you kids were young, we had you potty trained by 1.5.
Yes.
Is there a line we can use that says, well, our pediatrician says, I mean,
yes.
what would be the reason to wait?
That's right. Well, what I usually say to parents is, especially when grandparents and great parents are weighing in on this, in America, you know, our concept of child rearing, I mean, of toilet training, mm-hmm. our children has changed since our grandmother's generation, when kids tended to be trained younger. And I think that was partly because we weren't as child-centered then as we are now. It was more for the convenience of the parents, and also the advent of disposable diapers and pull-ups.
Mm-hmm.
So because if you're in a cloth diaper, that's pretty uncomfortable. The kids themselves were more motivated to get those things off because they were so uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think, you know, disposable diapers, Pampers, pull-ups, that kind of stuff has pushed it back a little bit. And we are a little bit more inclined to listen to the wishes and the needs of the child in this process.
Mm-hmm.
Because it can backfire, and you know, there are kids who can develop all kinds of problems if the toilet training is pushed on them.
Okay.
Constipation, that kind of thing, withholding.
Mm-hmm.
So it's way better for the child to be ready and a willing participant in this process.
Interesting. Okay.
And we had talked about, do we have to worry about a child? I know parents often worry about a child being potty trained before they go to either daycare or preschool. And kind of pushing it for that purpose. And again, so what do we do with that with preschools?
Well, that's an excellent question, Lori. I just advise parents early in the process, ask the child care provider what their policy is.
Mm-hmm.
Because some of them really do want children to be trained, and some of them are very willing to say, this is a developmental process and not everybody does it at the same time.
Okay.
So really, but it is something you need to ask up front.
So there's no requirement to go to preschool. In fact, I was checking into that in terms of state regulations, you can't require,
right.
if it's a licensed child care center, it can't require that a kid be potty trained before they're ready. But I think parents often hear, you can't go to preschool unless your child's potty trained.
That
right.
is correct. Because I remember that I had spoken to many parents, and even when I had Ari, and they were mentioning that, oh, is she potty trained? And because, you know, she can't go to school, they won't accept her. She's not potty trained. And I'm like, oh, really? That's, you know,
yeah.
quite interesting.
Just have to ask, because there is a wide variety of opinion about that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So mm-hmm. it seems like, are there any kind of other basics you want to go over with us, things to, you know, keep in mind?
I guess the one thing that comes up a lot is that the question about nighttime dryness. Like, when should we expect a child who's fully potty trained during the day to be dry at night?
Wow, yeah.
And when is it really considered bedwetting? And I think many people are surprised to hear this, but we don't consider it a problem until the child is 5 or 6 years old. Many, many kids are not dry at night, mm-hmm. even when they're fully trained during the day. So that's just, I think, a comfort to a lot of parents to know that they can sort of relax about that a little bit.
And we should put up the sticker chart. We put up an example of a sticker chart for kids because I think the idea of rewards is great.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, instead of focusing on what the kid's not doing is, this is great. And you can put whatever you want in there. You know, you pooped today, you peed today, you sat on the potty after dinner, whatever a parent wants to do.
Yeah.
And I liked your point, Timmy, you and I were talking about that. A lot of times we think we have to buy our kids something or give them candy, and it's not that you shouldn't if you want to as a parent, but just the positive, like, oh my gosh, you did this.
Praise.
With a star, you know, praise with or without a star.
With Ari, it used to be a high five. I would say, good job, Mama,
yeah.
Big girl.
Doesn't have to be a thing.
Exactly.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's something that my parents try to remind me, that what kids want most in life is our approval when they're young. So our enthusiasm is the biggest reward, and our disapproval when things aren't going well, when they're old enough to know better, is a really big thing as well.
Yeah,
so I
absolutely.
Try to remind myself of that.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you. We're going to have all this up on our website, all the information you gave us, so that parents want to be able to find it. So that's helpful. So nothing that we said today do you need to worry about memorizing. Everything about what to keep in mind and the general rules, rules of thumb for potty training. So we, as I mentioned earlier, there are a number of other topics we've covered over the last couple of years. We've covered tantrums. We've covered what to do when a child has a tantrum in public was a very common thing. How to help kids transition in and out of the car, in and out of daycare. We've covered autism. We've covered asthma. We've covered how do you parent when you're in crisis as a family. So if you want to find any of that, you can go to parentinginaction.org, and we invite you to submit to us your questions and also your advice. It could be about potty training. It could be anything. On Facebook, we have a whole page. Just go to Facebook and look for Parenting in Action, and you'll be able to give advice to other parents, which can be really helpful to us. Now, the other thing we try to do every week on the show is Tip of the Week, which is something relevant to the topic we're talking about. This time, what we want to remind you is that every one of us has a time in our life as a parent where we need some advice or some support. And we are so blessed in Boston that we have resources. So there are people who will come do a home visit with you at home. You can call 24 hours a day, the parental stress line. Or you can go on to talkreadplay.org, the website, and find out all kinds of free activities and resources for raising kids in the city. And I think, you know, I don't ever take for granted how lucky we are as a city to have those sorts of free resources. So I've even heard that for some parents, the struggle with potty training is, I need to get my kids out of diapers because diapers are so expensive.
Yeah.
So again, I really encourage you to use these resources to be able to figure out, how can I find affordable diapers? What can I do if I'm having trouble feeding my family and one of us is unemployed? Those are the sorts of resources that are there for you.
Yeah.
So that is what we know so far about potty training. What would be tonight's takeaway?
Well,
this?
For me, tonight's takeaway so far, what I've gotten out of it is that every child is different. Potty training is not a race. So you have to get to know your child, know his or her personality. And the way you're going to do that is by paying attention to all these little details, like Dr. Eileen Costello says, pay attention, get to know your child, get to know the sign when the child needs to go to the bathroom, try to encourage him or her not to be in the diaper. And you know what? Accident happens. We can clean it up. So what? They go into on the floor. For example, sometimes, you know, when I was younger, when I'm bathing her, she would say, oh, mommy, I got to pee while I'm bathing her. I got to poo. And I said, okay, go in the bathtub. I'll pick it up. It's not a big deal. Don't make the child feel uncomfortable for something that's natural. That is the whole thing. Let them do it naturally. And for those who are giving us pressure or making some kind of competition, this is not a competition. This is not modeling or nothing like that. Yeah, good, I'm happy. Your child can go early. So what? Mine is coming, and that's not a problem. So, you know,
it's a good relax.
Stick on that.
It's a great relax attitude. All right. So keep us posted on what your questions, your advice, your ideas are as parents. And as usual, as I always tell you, we'll see you next week. And in the meantime, one of the big themes of our show, take care of yourself.
Absolutely.
So you can enjoy your kids. See you next week.